So being past 7:30, call the meeting to order, and we'll start with our first item, cable television renewal license approval, Comcast. If you'd like to, Cable Advisory Committee, would like to come forward, Mr. August.
Sure, thank you very much.
I don't know. One just a second.
You've heard from us before. I'm William Dean. I'm just here as a representative of the Cable TV Committee. And to my right is William August, the attorney who's been our consultant and the negotiator for the town with Comcast. The you had in your packet the copy of the proposed I won't take too much time here. I'll just maybe summarize the summary. It is focusing on the money. The proposal is for a 10-year license term, which is the maximum allowed. The money breaks down into actually three categories. One is $150,000 for capital expenditures. This can be used for cable-related needs or the cable-related portion of the town's INET. This $150,000 exceeds what we, the committee, actually thought we would be able to get from Comcast. And I can detail that if anyone's interested how to sort of evaluate that number. Comcast also agreed to our request for an option after 5 years to increase the subscriber surcharge from 3.5% of gross revenues to 4.25%. It's entirely the town's option. It provides some flexibility in case expenses are greater. And we also, the town also has the option to spend that excess as it sees fit on any cable-related or INET need. The third and last money item, which I think is really quite a coup and to the credit of our negotiator, is the has to do with the so-called backhaul system. It's the backhaul buyout system. The backhaul, you remember, is the set of cables that provides video origination from remote buildings and transmits the signals to the broadcast center at the town hall. The Comcast, Verizon has a backhaul system, Comcast has one. Comcast one was in need of upgrading as well as annual maintenance. And what we're able to do is to get them to agree to pay the town in lieu of them doing that upgrading and maintenance. And the reason for that is that the town's INET, when it becomes operational, will provide that functionality. So it's avoiding duplicate installation and providing a financial benefit to the town of as much as $30,000. And that will be dependent on how soon the INET is able to fulfill that that function. So what's especially nice about that is that that $30,000 is not subject to pass through to the subscriber. So it's money from Comcast to the town. We're basically sharing the economy of not having a duplicate system. And the other thing I mentioned is that all funds from Comcast will flow to the town. That's been the case for Verizon for several years now. And it was not the case with the original Comcast contract. But it'll make for more regularity in how the finances are handled. So that's overall, the committee thinks this is a very favorable agreement. The disappointments were very minor and few. The money items especially were very favorable to the town, and so the committee voted unanimously to recommend that you approve the license. We'd be happy to, either one of us can answer any of your questions.
Thank you, Mr. Green. Mr. August, do you have anything to add to that
summary? No, I
summary?
Think that's a great summary. I just want to say a couple of thank yous. I'll try to be super brief. Rick, who a lot of town managers delegated out, which Rick did, but he was just so intimately understanding of every question that came up at any time, and, you know, just helped us all figure it out. And, Jim Shea was, I've got to hire Jim Shea. He's unbelievable. very precise, every single, we went through so many drafts, you know, you get to the end, it seems like, oh, it's all together, but just, you know, very on top of every issue, technically and reasonable, and just, you know, worked all the issues through the committee, and, you know, always got back promptly, both Rick and Jim. So it's a lot of value to the town. It was very, very good. And likewise, Comcast was a good negotiation partner. Jim and I were on many conference calls with them, and they did take the time to understand, like, what we were saying and how we wanted to change things a little bit from the mold, especially with the contribution to the town, because the town's building its own fiber, and seeing how that would be mutually beneficial, and therefore not passing it through. They really heard us out, and, you know, the company to have us on the other side of the table worked out pretty well.
Great, I guess we could add that the lateness of the, we're about a month late in the process, and that was, I think, due not to any recalcitrance on the part of Comcast, but just some unfortunate timing of vacations of some people that needed to approve the license.
Right. Comcast vacation.
Comcast vacation. Yeah. Let's make it clear who it was.
Yes, sir.
Holding
for right. Yeah, they were very good. So, you know, I think that should be recognized. As
great. Are there any questions?
So the senior discount is, as far as the paperwork goes, they manage that, right?
Yes, this is, of course, an entirely voluntary thing. We cannot, you know, set rates, but they have renewed the senior discount. It's explained in one of the side letters.
Right. And that's only for the basic package?
It actually, now it's the $2 off the standard service. They had sent us a first draft for it being 10% off basic, but actually the $2, like 95% of the subscribers are above the basic level, so it reaches a bigger population. We went for the other option. Those two options are not negotiable. You can pick one or the other, but they won't negotiate rate matters. So they have either a, we could go either way on that. You know, if there are other ideas, but there's the 10% off basic, means tested, you have to be income eligible, is one option, and then there's another senior discount option, $2 off the expanded basic, what they call standard service, same means testing, and when given the choice and aware of the choice, most towns go with the one that reaches the larger group, the above basic subscribers. And that had been the indication from the town earlier on, so we just got that letter. There may have been some confusion on that, because first they sent us a letter with the discount off the basic and set the standard, and then we substituted the one we had originally asked for.
Thanks.
Mark?
I would just thank you all for all of the work you've done. I mean, I think negotiating a 10-year successor contract for cable, it's probably alternately fascinating, and alternatives to fascinating. and it takes a lot of detail, and it's a lot of work. I know it is. I have one very minor comment, which is that there are repeated references to us as the Board of Selectmen, and having gone to town meeting many times to change the title, I show it. It's a minor thing. It's in. I can show you where they are, but.
I might ask the Charter Review Committee to reconsider.
Yeah, too late now.
Select board now?
No, we are the select. We are the Bedford Selectmen.
Okay.
Yeah. No board.
No board. No. We're not a board.
No, a word.
I noticed that the RFR, that where the RFP would get into
bored.
Next.
Caroline?
No. I'm all set.
I'd say a great letter to the editor while I'm here. I've never had anyone see that. That was a super strong letter.
I just add my congratulations and thanks to the committee and to Mr. August for a job well done. I'm pleased to see that the negotiation turned out even better than expected, and as you noted, the slight delay, it seems as though everything has come together in the end. So it's a job well done.
Right. Thank you very much. I have the signature copies here. Should I circulate them and just bring them up? Or
should vote on?
Sure. If someone wants to make a motion, then we can.
Sure. Selectmen approve a 10-year renewal license with, say, Comcast?
Comcast.
Comcast of Massachusetts, Inc.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstained? 400. Excellent. Now we can sign.
First copy is single-sided. I don't have just one copy signed. Oh, okay.
And I'll just take this moment to ask our technician whether or not the video monitor should be on over there. I think it's helpful. It was on earlier.
Let me just make sure I don't remember signing.
Nothing happens exciting in 10 minutes. It shuts
itself. Self-regulating.
I think it's good because it reminds us that we're on television.
Okay.
Thank you. It's a problem. We can do without it.
So did Mark want to change this? Let's let it go.
Definitely not.
We can change it in the rest of the. All right. I think we'll move on without the video then.
Okay.
As long as we're actually being recorded, it's fine. Okay, so now we'll move on to the Cable Television Committee recommended request for proposals for PEG access.
Right, so here I am again. Just to review briefly, the last time we discussed the RFP for the PEG access was in February 18th. I summarized for you where we were in the document. There was a lot of back and forth at that meeting, which led to quite a few revisions, actually. I would say that they were more in form and including clarity rather than in substance in terms of the main features of the RFP and the contract. The week after that February 18th meeting, Jim Shea, the committee chair, and myself and Mr. Reed had a six-hour editing session, which we made extensive revisions that reflected Mr. Moonen's comments, as well as ideas that Mr. Reed had. Since then, the town council has had several opportunities to look at the document and has made what I describe as technical changes on have to do with some of the legal wording. So it has the document has received a lot of attention since February. I'd be happy to again to answer any questions you have, but I just in summary say that I think the main features of this of the RFP and the new contract are sort of in three categories. One is compared to the existing contract, there's more active financial management by the town. And this reflects the committee's belief that the funds that come to the town and distributed by the town for the deserve no less care and stewardship than if it were tax money. It's money coming from Bedford citizens for their benefit, and that the town does need to be an active, you know, steward in managing these funds. So to that end, in the new RFP and contract, there's an annual budget approval process, which includes both operating and capital funds. In addition, there is a provision which all the funds are coming from Comcast or Verizon now in the future directly to the town. And so the town is managing any balances that occur. And the town has some flexibility to have a surplus that retains in a revolving fund in a given year, or if the need should arise, to actually spend more than is coming in from the cable providers. But it's now a budgetary process that centers on the town's needs. I think also that there's more clarity in the expectations in terms of financial or other reporting. There's more clarity about the dates in which we want certain information that we were so concerned, I think, previously about what was expected. And then, of course, you're all aware that the town meeting approved the town's option to extend the contract to a fourth or fifth year. And this was recommended by the committee as an incentive for potential bidders, because it obviously provides them more stability, and we're hoping that we can encourage more bidding and use that as a way to reward the successful contractor for good performance when the year expires. So those are the main provisions, and I try to answer any of your questions about what was changed or what, you know, where I stand. And the other committee members are here to pitch in if I get stuck.
Great, thank you. Are there any questions, Caroline?
I just was wondering if you can expand a little bit further on the backside of your first page. You talk about cash surpluses and reserves in its possession that belong to the town. And I don't know that I've heard of that before, but yeah. Could you expand a little bit further
there's
on what that is?
I've very much discussion of that before. I'm glad you asked, because it's a very important thing. It is related to both the current contract and also the structure of the RFP. A provision of the current contract, and one that's carried forward even more explicitly is that essentially that the monies that are coming to the town from the cable licensees are town funds, and that the town and that any surplus that exists at the end of a contract is these funds should be returned to the town. As I said, that's a provision in the current contract, and one that will be very important for us to exercise. As you could see here, our estimate based on old data is that the current contractor has accumulated a surplus of something like $200,000. And you know that at town meeting, items much smaller than that were subject to a lot of discussion. And so this is a major amount of money. There's the principle that I think that the committee believes unanimously that it is the town money. It should be treated, as I said earlier, as if it were tax revenue, and with the same care. Town control of the surplus provides the funding flexibility that I was spreading a minute ago to either fund in excess of income in a given year or otherwise use that money in a way that suits the town's needs best in a given year. For the new, a provision of the new contract is that to provide operating capital for the PEG access provider, we will we're proposing to pay 25% in advance, so that the operator has that much as a cushion. And to be able to fund that 25%, we actually need to recover the excess funds from the current contract, because we have no other budget to do that. So in summary, I would say both for that practical reason going forward, as well as to be consistent with the principle that these are the town's funds. We're very strongly about this, recovery. In the new RFP, the way the annual budgeting process is structured, there will be no big surplus accumulated by the contractor, because the money is coming to the town, and there will be a budgeting, process each year, and adjustments could be made on that basis. So this won't occur in the future, but it's a big issue in the coming months between now and July 1.
Okay. Thank you. Absolutely.
Mike, Mark.
So that any surplus goes into the revolving fund?
I'm not an expert on the town the accounting system. I guess it's the revolving fund. Jim would.
Yes, the cable television revolving account.
I just want to make one suggestion in the draft contract under 14, section 6, on criminal background screening. This seems to be in the subject of Corey checks. And I believe that under the Corey process, volunteers are also should be subject to the screening, as well as staff and officers and directors, and they do use volunteers, which is great. So I didn't know whether you needed to add that to the screening lineup there.
Yeah, this is entirely the town council language. I mean, we didn't have any part of this.
Mm-hmm.
I don't have an opinion.
Once again, thanks so much to the committee for the efforts invested in the RFP.
Thank you.
Rick, is there anything else that we need to know before we take a position on this RFP?
No. I think, the intention tonight was for the selectmen to see this for one final time and consent to it so that it can be advertised and we can begin the procurement process for the new contract.
The clock is ticking, so to speak, because we need to advertise it soon because of there's going to be some delays in publication. And, have a reasonable time period for doing this proposal. So we're hopeful that we can have it on the street, in the next week or two.
Would you like a motion from us approving
yes,
the RFP?
Yes, that'd be good. Sure.
I'll move the selectmen approve the request for proposals for cable television, public educational, and governmental access services for the period beginning July 1, 2014, as presented.
Second.
So moved and seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, abstained, 400.
Do we need to move the draft?
The draft contract?
That's part of the RFP.
Part of the RFP.
Okay, great.
It's exhibit one of the RFP.
Thank you.
Okay, so next on our agenda is the DPW, and we're a little ahead of schedule.
Good evening.
Good evening, Mr. Sorensen, Ms. St. John, and you've got Ms. Domigan with you, too.
Are you going to stand over here?
Yes.
All right, so while everyone knows Trish from VHB, right?
How are you? Now
so,
I got a microphone.
As we get started, tonight what we're going to do is we're going to review, and I believe last July we did presented this to the Board of Selectmen, the Bedford Selectmen. Basically, on South Road, at Great Road, signalized intersection, Schoolway, Elm Street, Maple Reconstruction, which brought to attention was it last year?
November 2012.
Okay. And also the fire station preemption signal. So right now, Tricia's going to walk us through what we're going to be doing. We're getting to send this project out to bid, and we want to make sure that you guys get privy of this one more time, take a look at it. And at that, you are you on, Trish?
I think this has to warm up, so if you want to keep on talking, Roy.
So what we talked about was originally putting these projects are separate. We're going to put them together, get one contract. We think it's going to work in our favor as far as price goes, obviously with staging and construction. We're not going to have multiple companies on top of each other. We'll be able to, again, stage it better and set it up better through one contractor. So we'll go over these plans tonight. And if there's any questions, feel free and we'll answer them. We're going to review the funding as well. Is what we think it might cost.
Okay, should I sing?
Just be glad it's not town meeting.
I don't know why it's not going in.
Yeah, why don't we want to go over the funding now?
Sure.
I'll let Adrian walk through the funding. We got an initial estimate from VHB on what we think the construction might be.
So the combined three projects, again, Schoolway, Marchway, Maple Street, the new signals, revised, replaced signals at South Springs and Great Road, and the new preamp signals at the fire department. That estimate is approximately today's dollars, $1.7 million. Special town meeting 2012 appropriated $350,000. That was for the Schoolway Maple Street, Elm Street. Then last year we worked to the board, excuse me, to the selectmen, requesting $370,000 to finish off that project. Mm-hmm. We are going to be using another funding source. Currently we have about $200,000 in our FY 14 operating budget for paving, which brings us to a balance of about $750,000 that we're going to require a new Chapter 90 request, which we will do once we know what actually that dollar value will be, and we'll make that request over to Mass DOT. Currently, we have about $900,000 in our Chapter 90 account. The FY 13 letters came last week. Bedford's allotment is $627,000. Again, it depends on that final bond bill being released. So even without the bond bill, we would still have enough money in our Chapter 90 accounts to fund the balance of this project, basically meaning two signals. Which were never really on, never went to a town meeting vote, nor have they been appropriated for our Chapter 90 accounts. So those are the basically the four accounts: town meeting, social town meeting, the last year's Chapter 90, the balance of our operating budget, current year operating budget, and then a new request will be made to Chapter 90 accounts.
Can you break down the? I'm sorry.
No, I was going to ask the same thing. If you can break it by the, so the three projects, if the 350 we have was to do school, Mudge, Maple.
The 350 plus the 370. The 350, which was originally appropriated at town meeting, and yep. The 370,000 that we requested last year from Chapter 90.
So the 350 was for the portions of the project that are not eligible for Chapter 90 funds. Yeah. And so then we bunched those two together to do the Schoolway, Mudgeway, Maple portion.
Yes. So So that...
So that's about $700,000 of the million, of the 1.7 million.
It is, except we've added a couple of things. For instance, fire department, we added some conduits, facilities added some conduits. We're going to look at some decorative streetlights, a little bit more costly than was originally proposed. So the total for that project is $950,000. So the two signalized intersections are about $750,000.
Combined.
Signals, the conduit work, the preempt going back to dispatch. There's some modifications have to be done to the fire station itself to get the conduits not only up to the building, but in through the walls, over the ceiling, and into the apparatus floor. So basically how it works is when the fire department, I don't want to go too far, when the fire department get a call, they will push one or two buttons, they either go to the right or to the left.
Okay.
Yeah, self-control.
Okay, so the price tag includes all of that hardware, the conduit, and getting
wiring
into the wiring into the fire station. And then over at the intersection where the signalization at Great and South and Springs is, I would imagine there's also a portion of landscaping and alteration of the corner right there where the organics is.
This traffic signal is being designed with the Great Road Master Plan in mind. So the curb line actually gets smaller, the road becomes narrower, and in that area there are obviously better pedestrian access, but also there's a little bit of strip of landscaping. I think there's a tree going in the strip. Mm-hmm.
So in that case it's the signal and all of the things that go with the hardware of the signal plus some recurving. Right.
Brand new traffic controller to be set aside the one that's there now.
Okay. Still having technical difficulties.
Yeah.
So I'm concerned about the amount of Chapter 90 money that this is projected to exhaust. Was what did you say on top of the 370? Was it another almost 800,000?
That we'll be making requests to Chapter 90, depending on what the bid prices come in.
And was that size of a Chapter 90 allocation part of the original projection? Do you remember? I mean, it seems like a lot especially when you factor in what the current balance is and what is what the first number for this year that you received is that going to leave sufficient funding for other work that needs to be done?
Well, like I said, we expect an immediate release of the $627,000. There's another $300,000 that's in the wings. I don't know if it gets released. So there's almost $1 million in Bedford's account that's almost on the edge, not including the almost $1 million that we have now. But to answer your question, I really don't know that we ever thought of how we were going to fund. You know, we just did the study, and we got it geared up towards the master plan, and then we added the fire department, but we never thought about going to town meeting to request specific funds for that project. I think it was always in my background that it was going to be appropriated out of our Chapter 90.
So is the fire department, I'm sorry, just to clarify, there's obviously the issues having to do with the signalization, the preemption signal on the Great Road. But did you also say that the fire department is adding something on the Elm Maple School project as well?
They've asked for some conduits. While we have Elm Street under construction, they've asked for some conduits.
Going?
Basically, they come down Elm Street. They will connect, or they will start at the Verizon manhole that's in the intersection. They come down. I believe they're trying to upgrade their fire alarm digital network. I'm not sure.
Okay.
I do know that the facilities request for additional conduits is the purpose of tying in the town center building to the old town hall.
Right. Trish, you want to give us your presentation?
I do.
Orally.
Actually, I can turn my screen around so
you
can see it.
You could.
I apologize for this. I'll give you a status update of the three projects. So as Adrian had mentioned, if that's okay. I really am sorry about this.
You could bring your laptop right there and we could see it.
Do you want to do that?
Well, so you don't have a print,
no.
You don't have, you didn't,
I didn't
print your...
I didn't print it out, no.
We can, if you want, we can get those to you after tonight.
Okay. I think it would be important to see exactly the scope of work.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
It's not getting a signal.
It's not, I don't know why it's not.
Maybe it's related to our monitor.
Very strange.
Can you email the presentation to us right now?
In 15 minutes. I have to go into my network.
Because...
Could you skip me and I could come back?
Yeah.
Do you
and then
that?
We can print it upstairs and hand it out to them.
Okay.
All right.
We'll do that.
Okay, so we're going to get some printouts of the presentation? All right, that's fine then. Okay, yeah, so we'll move on. We'll double back to the, unless, is that everything for DPW other than Trish's presentation?
Yes.
At this point? Okay.
Yes.
Okay. So I think we can move ahead then with the alcohol beverages rules and regulations. Proposed policy. Mr. Reed, do you want to say?
Yes. The selectmen had reviewed the draft of the amendments to the rules and regulations governing alcoholic beverages at their December 16th meeting. Since at that meeting there were a few different changes that were identified by the selectmen. One of the decisions was to allow the service of two alcoholic beverages without an order of food. And food has been actually ordered from the menu to be consumed on the premise. I think that's really the only major change that was, oh, I'm sorry, yes, there was also a decision at the December 16th meeting to allow managers and assistant managers the ability to recertify for online training program. In all other respects, the proposals are the same. The draft of the document that you have you tonight highlights the changes that relate to those things I just mentioned in the draft by shading the language in gray. In doing the change to the online training, it was noticed that language was missing, I think, elsewhere, so we duplicated it to make it more clear. I'm sorry, I'm confusing the online training. It was actually the service of the two alcoholic beverages. So, in other words, it's both included in the restaurant and now and also for an all-alcoholic beverage license, as well as the section for just wine and malt beverage licenses for two. And the one last little edit or change that was made today was on page 17. We passed out to you tonight a new page 17. And the difference was to separate under service limitations on page 17. The limitation regarding pitchers of beer being served from the other limitations that are part of the Alcoholic Beverage Control Commission's regulations under section 4.03 of their regulations. And we're actually attaching a copy of section 4.03 to these regulations. Do you all have those? I think we passed them out tonight.
Yeah.
So you can understand what they are.
Okay, are there any questions or concerns?
I have a few, just language language changes or grammatical changes. I don't know that we want to go through that at this point. Nothing changes the content.
To the policy?
Well, so I think that's my question. I initially saw them in the memo, and I'm going through the policy to make sure they are. In fact, I'll give you two examples, and then you can know what I'm talking about. So on the memo, the first bullet says to clarify that server training. To me, we're not clarifying it, we're confirming it. And I don't know that that is that big of a deal of a word in where it sits in the actual policy. And a couple of other smaller ones like that.
On page 4, okay. Under set number 3, about 3 sentences in, I think. 1, 2, 3. It says managers and assistant managers shall be certified prior to assuming the duties of the manager or assistant manager, respectively.
Okay, so the bullet on the memo isn't actually worded somewhere in the policy.
Correct.
Correct, okay.
It's just a paraphrasing of the change in the policy. And that particular bullet remains unchanged from what was proposed on the December 16th meeting.
Okay. Well, if that's the case, then what I saw in the policy is okay.
Okay. Mark?
So the breakout of page 17 does raise a question for me. It's not completely clear to me, Rick. So under wine and malt, we're calling out these limitations, service limitations, one of which is no pitchers of beer may be served. We don't have the same called out limitation under all alcohol licenses. So it's
correct. So I think what you need to do is look at the state's regulations under 4.03,
right.
Subparagraph F of that. It's 1F, actually. Shorten it and say, no licensee or employee or agent of a licensee shall F sell office offer to sell or deliver malt beverages or mixed drinks by the pitcher except to two or more persons at any one time. So these regulations apply regardless of the town of Bedford's alcohol beverage policy, and they apply to all on-premise license holders, whether they're all alcohol or wine and malt.
Okay.
So the distinguishing factor here is that what we have chosen to do in the wine and malt beverage situation only is essentially go further than what the state does and say that regardless, no pitchers may be served at a wine and malt
licensed establishment. Right. Okay. So, but the opposite is true, which is that an all alcohol establishment, consistent with the state regulations,
they can serve.
Which at least explains why they're earlier in our policy we describe what pitchers are and carafes of wine, pitchers of beer.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. I was just trying to make sure we were consciously saying that. Apparently we are. Okay. The only other thing I guess I would just like to comment briefly, because I know that we've had some concern about the one drink or two drink limit. I don't know whether we have anyone else who was going to comment on that here, but we do have a memo, and I want to be sensitive to the fact that we have a prevention services coordinator, you know, whose job is to pay attention to some of these things. But I'm just personally, I'm inclined to stay with our current recommendation of allowing two drinks, but I just want to make sure that it's clear that we're talking about that still in a situation where food has to be available to people. Yes, it's possible to not order food right away, but the guidelines that were sent to us talk about snacking. I think we heard from owners and proprietors who are well aware that it makes no sense to serve people without also trying to provide some form of food. Right now we require a full menu serving of something, and we're trying to allow them a little more leeway, but it's not the case that we are trying to encourage people to be in situations where they're drinking without eating. And unfortunately, there's a line in here that implies that somehow we are not paying attention to drinking and driving as an issue in town, and I really don't see how that comes out in any of the policy changes that we're proposing. I value very much everything that Youth and Family Services provides, and I value their perspective. I just think that they're being a little harsh in the memo they sent to us, and I think that there are reasons why we can consider not backtracking from two drinks at this time, and if it's an issue, we will have to address it, and we will have to address it aggressively. But we also have a history of addressing all kinds of issues around alcohol aggressively, and I don't know why we would not do that if that situation arose. So I just don't want it to go unsaid, because I know they spent time sending us their opinion, and I don't want to just not pay attention to their opinion. I just think that there are pros and cons, and that's what we're struggling with.
Thanks, Mark. Mike, do you have any comments?
Well, I was struggling with this too, because we do want to be consistent with our own departmental programs. I didn't realize that some of what's being presented seems a little extreme. Never drink alcohol and drive a car. So that means anyone who goes out to dinner in the town and has a glass of wine should get a designated driver. We have quite a traffic problem already. It seems like the message is compromised by unrealistic considerations like that. I know that they're doing this in good faith, and I think since the intent here is to serve alcohol with food, and that was one of the concerns, that I'm ready to support the change and monitor it closely. But I don't think it's going to be a radical change in behavior in establishments that we have now.
Do we have any feedback from the police department since the first time that we spoke about this? They haven't raised any particular concerns.
No.
I think just to echo what Mike and Mark have said, that in no way does changing this policy backtrack us on our enforcement of any violations of the policy or violations of the liquor laws, which I feel is that we take quite seriously, and we've seen in the past year instances where there were violations, and you know, the people came before us and we were responsible for responding appropriately, and I think that we all take that commitment very seriously, having heard from a lot of the business owners about the difficulty in making their businesses work, and having heard from residents about their wish to support local businesses and be able to enjoy a meal with a glass of wine in town instead of having to actually go someplace else or a dessert or an appetizer. I think this really addresses some economic issues and also some quality of life issues for folks who would like to see some restaurants come into town, and I think this will help us be able to attract some amenities that people in town would be interested in supporting. So I feel, you know, I thank you, Mark, for bringing up the memo. I feel the same way. It's important to respect the perspectives, and certainly it has not been unanimous. People have also addressed concerns to me about issues with making this change, but I feel comfortable that we will be responsible about it and monitor it. And if there's trouble, or if there's problems, or if we feel as though it's not working for the community, the nice thing is that it's our policy and we can revisit it.
Agreed.
So if we approve this policy change this evening, then will we send out notification to our permit holders about the change, or what will the next step be?
I'm sorry, I'm distracted by
I was just asking sort of how will the next steps unfold if we go ahead and approve this policy change?
Well, we will distribute the new policy to all of the license holders just to let them know that it's in effect. That's all.
Okay. Any other questions, concerns, discussion? Anyone in the audience have anything to add to the conversation? Thank you.
So, a motion to approve the...
Yes.
I'll move the Selectmen approve the updated rules and regulations governing alcoholic beverages for the town.
Second.
Dated April 7th. Dated
April 7th. Thank
Still
you.
Second.
April 2nd or April 7th?
7th.
Okay.
Yeah, we'll use today's date.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. If there's no further discussion, all those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Abstained? 400.
Where are we?
Okay, so have we... are we ready to return to the VHB presentation yet? No?
No.
Okay. All right. Okay. All right, technical difficulties. We can move on. So next on our agenda is the Air Force Community Partnership Initiative and a discussion of possible ideas for sharing resources. So Mike, is this something that you can update us on?
The Air Force is embarking on some ambitious partnership exercises in different parts of the country, including here with our own Hanscom Air Force Base. And the goal is to look for and implement ways to integrate services and activities that would eliminate overlap, save the military some money, and in the process maybe save the municipalities some money as well, and enhance some of the services provided. There was an initial meeting on March 19th that was attended by representatives of the four contiguous towns, as well as the Port Authority, the VA, the Governor's Task Force, and a lot of military representatives. And the discussion was moderated by some representatives from the Pentagon who outlined the process and initiated it through a whole litany of ideas from the Hanscom Civil Engineering Department as potential ways to integrate services and look for savings. Just one quick example, it was noted that there are separate snowplowing operations for the Air Force, the Port Authority, Lincoln Laboratories, the towns, and they're all very close together. Sometimes contiguously, all doing the same thing. Seems like there could be some savings realized there. Other ideas were a little bit less obvious, including perhaps the new schoolhouse on base could become a charter school and even have paying customers. The point being that they're looking for they're trying to be very creative and imaginative in this process. Now, what happens next? They've broken it down into four general categories, with a host of ideas attached to each one. And through Colonel Weilacher, who's nominally calling the shots here, they're looking for input from the stakeholders in these four areas. The next general meeting is scheduled for May 7th, and in the interim, they're asking for input, and I think that would actually be a commitment of some time for people in areas that are specifically under the category of work, which is primarily public works, live and learn, which includes things like schools, web pages, office space, child development center. It's kind of a catch-all category. Parks and recreation, that's self-explanatory, and public safety. And the way I read the memo, I think that they're looking for input from the professionals in these areas. Mr. Reed and I were representing the town at the opening session, and I'd like to continue to be involved because I think it's important to be represented and to demonstrate that we care about these processes. It's hard to make a case that you want the installation to remain here when we don't invest the time in something that's so important to them. Rick, I don't know if you had time to process that last memo from Colonel Weilacher about the working groups.
I've just shared it with our department heads and asked them to let me know if they're available to serve on any of these working groups.
It seems like that's what they're looking for, although nothing specific has been scheduled. They're talking about having these discussions during April. One of the things that Rick brought up at the general meeting was, gee, it would be nice if the golf course was more available up on Springs Road than it has been. And if you talk about revenue potential and shared services, well, there's something right there but base personnel also suggested that it might be that some of their ball fields might be available. I don't know how they've quite gotten by the idea of access yet, but it sounds like they're ready to be flexible on things like that. So that summarizes the process as it stands, and although decisions and implementation aren't on the near horizon, I think it's in our interest to continue to be part of the process.
It's interesting because in some cases the crossovers are really quite clear. When you're talking about parks and recreation, you'd say, well, we need people with, you know, rec department experience and, you know, programs or field needs or whatever it is. Public safety, obviously, you know, you've got your police, fire, emergency response. But then the live, learn category, it just seems to me that you could go and participate in from, you know, a tremendous variety of different perspectives. You're talking about schools, you're talking about mass transit. There it seems like there's great opportunities there, but I think it's also, you know, it could represent a huge time sink if you were trying to go there and interact on all of these scores. I just sort of wonder if it's something where, while we're, you know, participating and showing support for this process, there might be some opportunity for us to think about what are our needs and how do these intersect with these opportunities. Some internal thought about that. I mean, particularly when I'm looking at this list and I see mass transit and commuter parking as part of the Live Learn category, and that's something that's come up on numerous occasions, that there were opportunities for folks to be able to access from the south, you know, get to Route 2, Alewife, commuter shuttles. There's now the REV, the bus that comes out of Lexington, and if Hanscom wanted to be a partner in trying to solve some of our commuting issues, but that issue is, you know, a specialty in one department, and then the idea of the schools and the STEM and, you know, the educational-based options. It seems to me you'd need a lot of people with a lot of different, diverse expertise to try to interact meaningfully about such a diverse array of opportunities.
Yeah, I don't think that they're telling us that we only need one person for each of these areas.
I know, but what I mean is that this, from my point of view, this could turn into a tremendous time commitment on the part of many people.
But not everything on the list is going to be pursued either. This is just an early stage discussion process to determine what items on these lists or any other items might be selected to move further along.
So they're looking for representatives from the community to give input about this discernment process that they're in, about what,
yes,
where are the areas of overlap where the communities might be interested.
Yes, or what are the most, what areas are the most likely to be fertile ground for pursuit?
I think there'll be some low-hanging fruit identified, and mm-hmm, the entire process, I think, will take the better part of the year.
Well,
Mike, you talked about something that shows up in their sample as a concern, which is public access to the base, but security of the base. And have they had any discussion of that yet?
You mean in the context of this or overall?
In the context of this, in the sense that some of these things are facilities that they have that they might share more broadly, and that some of these things are things that the communities provide that the base may be able to take advantage of, but they're taking advantage of our, especially in the sense of facilities, is a lot easier as they come off the base and go to any of our communities than our access to the base itself.
This is an obvious question that wasn't raised at the initial session because I think it was, I don't know how everybody else felt. I felt it wouldn't be appropriate to start poking holes in the ideas before they even had a chance to present them. But it is an obvious question.
It's like a fundamental question, though, because there's a barrier to entry there that may be difficult for it from the point of view of a...
I was kind of concerned to read that some guy running away from the police was able to penetrate that barrier. I didn't really hear the details of how that happened or what that constituted, but several reports said he drove on base through the barrier. I don't know how he did it.
I don't think that was an accurate report.
Yeah, you got those zigzag barriers there. I don't know how you could do that at a high speed without...
I think he turned around before he reached the barriers.
Yeah. Make more sense.
Having lived here long enough to remember how relatively easy it was to access the base before 9/11 and how much that encouraged mutual activity and integration, I don't know if we can go back to that, but it needs to be discussed.
You can only assume by putting this together and having this initiative and this mindset that is something that they've already thought of. I would be interested to see. I'm sure in the first brainstorming sessions that's going to be addressed. So are you looking for more involvement, or who will be involved, or what's kind of the ask at this point?
Right now, as far as the immediate future is our involvement pretty much covered by staff?
Yes, I think so. I mean, it's they have asked for us to provide names of people who would work in any of these four groups. So we're at a staff level. We're soliciting people to be involved in it or interest, and then.
Has this been shared with the school committee as well, since there are some school-related items?
No.
Let me see if it's...
I'm not sure if they sent it to the schools, the base personnel. I didn't scan the list of email addresses closely enough.
I've got the full email list, and it doesn't seem to be going to any schools in any of the local or... Middlesex or any of them, if you want me to capture this in a memo to the superintendent and forward it to him with a summary, I can do that. Although it doesn't seem like they're anxious to have people from the school districts initially involved as part of the conversation, or else they probably would have sent it to them. Yeah, there are plans to build two new schoolhouses on base at a cost of many millions of dollars. Initially, the middle school and then an elementary school.
So is there any action that we need to take at this point other than to just to be aware that this is ongoing?
Yes, okay. The latter.
Great. Thanks a lot, Mike. That was very interesting. Yep, I agree. Okay, so now we'll go back. Trish, are you ready?
It's up to you guys.
Since you can't, why don't you sit down and relax, Trish?
This is the view at 2 o'clock in the morning.
It's too bright.
I am terribly sorry about that.
Seems like it was on our end. Technical difficulties.
It's just not connected to the projectors.
Yeah. So, the three projects, what we did was we combined the three projects, the fire station, I think Adrian had gone over this when she talked about funding, the fire station, the intersection at South and Spring with the Gray Road and also Schoolway. I just wanted to give you a little bit of an update. The Schoolway project is complete and it's ready for bid. What we're doing is we're actually in the process of combining the three projects. Schoolway is pretty much complete. I think there was some issues with the type of lighting, and one of the graphics, the image that I have on there, is the type of street lighting that has been selected for the project. I think Adrian and Roy got a grant for LED lights, so they'll all be LED lighting for the ornamental lighting that's going to be placed on Schoolway. One of the reasons why the project was expensive is there's going to be pavement rehabilitation for Elm, for Maple, Rodney, and Foster. So there's a lot of, you know, pavement's pretty expensive, especially right now, so I think that probably increased the construction costs pretty significantly. Do you have a question? You look like you're about to say something.
No, I were Rodney and Foster, that wasn't part of the original discussion, and I think it's great that we can accommodate that neighborhood. Were those repaving priorities for the next year or two?
They are on the shortlisted plan by the pavement engineer.
So I guess there's some economy of scale to do them now.
Yeah, there's an economy of scale always when you try to group the projects together. That's one of the benefits of grouping these three projects together. There's in such close proximity, you don't really want contractors to be overlapping onto one another. So it's a good opportunity to group the three projects together. The Great Road at South Road and Springs, that project is complete. There's a few things. One of the issues that we wanted to take a look at was to improve the intersection geometry a little bit so that trucks can turn easier going on the Great Road from west to east, going onto South Road, going southbound. So we've done that. We actually took a look at all of the quadrants to make sure that any trucks turning into that intersection can do it with ease. You know, Springs Road is pretty tight, and there's really not much you can do there, but we smoothed out the geometry as best as we...
So you're talking about eastbound truck traffic turning right onto south?
That's correct.
Where the bus stop is?
Yes. Yep.
When Chris did a presentation back in July of last year, that was one of the things that came up in the design.
This is important because we've been told that school buses have trouble making that turn, so that's why they go the back way past the residences.
Yeah, so we've smoothed that out a little bit so they'll be easier. That's going to be an easier movement to make. One of the other things that we wanted to take a look at was the signal phasing at that location to make sure that it was optimal, and the timing and the phasing at that intersection is going to allow, you know, there's a lot of traffic on the Great Road and there's a lot of traffic on both Springs and South, but the traffic signal operations that we've designed at that location is going to optimize that completely. The fire station signal, we are in the process of finalizing that. We've been working with DPW and the fire department over the last couple weeks to finalize that. There were some questions, I think you had mentioned it, that there will be conduit put down on Elm Street to connect into the fire station. And one of the things that DPW was looking at was to be more cost effective in terms of putting down more conduit for the connectivity between the fire station and the intersection, the Springs South intersection. And there was, last week and the week before, they were taking a look at the existing conduit that's in the street, in the sidewalk, to see if that could be reused. Unfortunately, it is cracked, and there's no conduit in there that can be used. So we'll be putting in new conduit from the fire station to the intersection. Another request was to connect the fire station to police dispatch, and there is an existing conduit in the Great Road, and we will be using that to connect police and fire for the fire station. There's an image in here that just shows all the combined project itself and the pavement marking. So there'll be a little bit of landscaping and, like I said, ornamental lighting put on Schoolway. The mast arms that are going to be installed at the intersection, the South Road with Springs, and also at the fire station are going to be ornamental, similar to what you have down in Depot Park. The sidewalks are going to be upgraded. The wheelchair ramps will be upgraded so that it'll be ADA compliant. All the sidewalks on Elm and Schoolway are also going to be upgraded, and Maple. So it's a pretty significant project that is going to go under construction.
What's the material indicated for the crosswalks? Is that just painted, or is it going to be a textured?
No, it's going to be a textured crosswalk, yes.
Right.
Yep.
And you mentioned sidewalks, particularly caught my eye on Schoolway, and I apologize if I should know this, and we've gone through this. Or that might have been before, actually, my time. So is there a sidewalk on the right of Schoolway now?
No.
There are no sidewalks on Schoolway.
There's a very old sidewalk.
There's a short section of sidewalk that ends.
That's almost obliterated.
Yeah.
That's on the, if you're going towards the municipal campus, it's on the right side.
Essentially, there's no, the sidewalk ends more or less just past the rounded corner, and there's no existing sidewalk on the southern side at all.
So the sidewalk that we're proposing to add here starts down at the fire station, comes all the way down?
No, that exists.
That exists.
That exists.
This exists
to Elm.
Here.
Elm is the roadway that's going up and down.
Correct.
So that's Elm Street. There is a sidewalk on the residential side of Elm, which
okay.
is the west side.
Which is the reason why we're choosing the side we are on Schoolway.
That's right, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because with the amount of foot traffic that could safely go that way and not go to the municipal campus, but more so go to the schools, there'll be a crosswalk on the other end of Schoolway?
Yes, there's going to be crosswalks on both sides of Schoolway.
Right.
So it's going to be on the Maple and Elm Street side, and also on the Mudway side, there'll be
right.
crosswalks.
Yeah, that corner
is really sharp, and the sight distance is super, super
right.
terrible. Yeah,
right.
So we've smoothed the alignment out on Schoolway so that the sight distance going around that corner is going
mm-hmm.
to be better.
Okay.
We're stopping it so that people have to stop at that intersection
mm-hmm.
and then proceed. So the speeds will be reduced because of that.
Okay. Thanks.
Yep.
Trish, can I just ask regarding the Springs South intersection? I'm just making sure I understand this correctly. The directions of traffic and the number of lanes allocated to each direction. And it seems to me that if I'm looking at this correctly, that heading eastbound on the Great Road as you approach the intersection for the entire length of the common, it's got two lanes.
It has one lane, and then there's going to be a parking lane. There's an existing parking lane there.
Okay, so that's just not, so that's going to remain.
In the morning, because the peak is so high,
are
that's going to turn into a left, right turn lane, yes.
So the first couple of parking stalls?
That's correct, yes.
Okay, so this is not really representative of what is going to happen. There's going to be parking remaining on both sides of the Great Road.
That's right.
And then there's going to be a signage there indicating a no parking for the last two?
It's the last two, and it's just going to be a specific time of day.
Time of day.
Yes.
Gotcha. Good.
What happens now is people turn down Elm Street.
Yeah, people don't like to make that turn because, like you said, it was difficult. We're trying to protect the equipment there also, so we just wanted to make sure the geometry of the intersection was more accommodating to the traffic that's using it.
And the couple of parking on-street parking spots on South Road by Organics are remaining?
Yes. They are remaining, yes.
And so?
So what is happening there? And I wish I could zoom in to show you what was happening there. But in my mind, I am. We're actually shifting the sidewalk over at the spiral slightly.
Okay.
And there's an easement that's going to be needed at that location. By shifting the sidewalk over closer to their building, we're allowing for the parking to stay where it is, except right now what they're doing, the folks that are parking there are actually parking on the sidewalk, and
right.
it's not ADA compliant. It's really difficult to get through there.
It is.
So we're actually creating two legal formal parking stalls there and still allowing for South Road to be striped the same way.
And so does that mean there's still an egress out of their parking lot?
There's an egress, but there's not an access out of Southway. So the circulation, you can leave the stall, the spa on South Road,
mm-hmm.
but you cannot enter that way. So we're buttoning up the driveway pretty significantly, actually. So it's one way out.
Well, I mean, I've seen people use that as an alternative way to make that turn.
Yeah, even coming out of the gas station.
Yeah, coming out of the gas station, traveling
inside, yeah.
traveling in the parking lot from the gas station in front of Organics and exiting out onto South Road to make a left onto
Really?
Yes, really.
I do it all the time.
You weren't mentioning any names, though, right?
No, no, and I wasn't aware of anyone in particular doing that. So essentially, there's going to be a length of sidewalk with two parking stalls next to it.
That's correct.
And then there's going to be an egress out of the parking lot.
Spot, yes.
Spot, where that person is going to be allowed to turn left coming out of that parking lot?
Is there yes,
so
that's
that correct. There's someone going to pull out in front of parked cars into two travel lanes mm-hmm. and be permitted to turn left onto South Road?
Yes, it's going to be stopped, and they're going to have to allow for traffic to clear out of the intersection before they make that turn.
There's many times, most of the day, there's not cars backed up there.
That's
we're talking
correct.
About an
yeah,
hour
we're talking
of our day
about
that there's
especially at peak hour in the afternoon.
Correct.
When
yeah.
people are
that's probably
are
not when people
there.
Are trying to go through there.
Right. Okay.
The what we're also doing on the Great Road at that location is we're narrowing up the driveway. We're also narrowing Great Road there, so we're allowing for a sidewalk and green space because that whole section of
no
the roadway
land.
Is yeah. just one wide open driveway entrance, and what we're trying to do is narrow that up as much now before the utilities and before the master plan actually gets implemented and make it pretty dramatic. I think it's going
to
be.
Is there any limitation to what you can do in terms of that those parking stalls in that driveway, considering that there's an MBTA bus stop right there?
We're moving the MBTA bus stop.
Okay, so where's it going?
It's going to go in front of Old Town Hall.
So then we get the crosswalk to the common.
It's not a crosswalk.
Well, it should be if you're going to put a bus stop there.
Well, it's a ramp on both sides.
Yeah, there's a ramp on both sides, and if you're going to put
no
a
painted crosswalk,
if you're going to put a bus stop there, I think you're just going to be inviting people to cross the street there to catch the
we'll
bus.
We'll take a look at that.
Good, excellent.
Do we have to have a hearing on moving that bus stop?
No, actually, we talked to the T already. They're all set. It's not. It used to be there, actually. It was actually moved up to the intersection. I don't know how long ago. I don't remember. But it was at the Old Town Hall for a long period of time. And then they moved it to the intersection. So I don't think there needs to be a hearing, and they're all set. It's such a short distance that we're moving it to. They are okay with just moving the sign.
Great. One last question. On the intersection itself,
yep.
Spring South, great. Will there be turning arrows?
You mean the traffic signals?
The traffic signals. Will,
yes.
Correct.
Yes,
I thought that was a part of it. Okay.
Especially at rush hour
yeah.
going north.
Mm-hmm. And was there any thought to the those bike boxes, you know, those ways that you allow the bicyclists to make the turn in terms of making that? Because there are a lot of cyclists who are trying to make that turning movement with the cars. And I know there's some state-of-the-art in terms of how to stripe that or to paint it so that the bikes can
yeah.
do it.
We did not consider that at this location. It's so state-of-the-art that it's a little bit premature, at least as far as I can see. I'm not a big fan of bike boxes because I think that there's blind spots in people driving with bike boxes in the way. We could look at
the
it.
The bikes are there anyway.
I know,
so, I mean,
I
the fact
that.
Is that people are, to whatever extent that it's not safe the way it is, I think it would warrant, if it's just paint, you know, it would warrant at least looking at whether or not there's a safe way to deploy that.
To cross them,
yeah.
yeah. We can take a look at that. It was not included as the original design, but yeah, we can take a look at that.
So.
Say that again?
Mark.
Yeah, actually, a bike box goes in front of the stop line. Yeah, and then you put,
You mentioned an easement on the corner there at
yes.
Springs, and so what's
it's
the
actually
status?
Actually, not the easement. It's not at the corner. It's right along the property, the building itself.
Mm-hmm.
It's for the sidewalk?
It's for the sidewalk. We met with the property owner last week. We've actually met with them a few times, and I think they're willing to work with the town on securing the easement. I think there are concerns regarding snow removal on that sidewalk and the snow storage on their property and how it's going to be impacted by the installation of new traffic signals.
Do you know what corner the hardware is going to be installed for the traffic signal at South and Gray?
Yeah, the big box, you mean, the controller?
And the anchor?
The anchor.
I mean,
the base of the mast arm for the light? Or is it going to be, because you said it was going to be like...
There's going to be two mast arms, one going in each direction. Actually, there's four mast arms, one going on each direction, so they're actually on each one of the corners of the intersection. The controller, the big box that right. controls the intersection, is going to be placed fairly close to where it is right now, which is on the Sovereign Bank's...
on the, over on that bank, which is, I think, called Santander now, there's a historic watering trough
right.
that used to be the subject of some discussion. I just want to make sure that's not going to be messed with it anyway.
I think the Great Road Master Plan actually called for some...
It moved
the resetting of
it. We reset it as part of that back from the intersection a little bit. It's not going to be touched at this point.
Okay. Can I ask how many of the decorative lights that you how many do you propose to put on Schoolway? I'm a little concerned about overlighting.
There's four now. There used to be a lot more. I think there were eight, and we've reduced it to four. Yeah.
Right.
The type of signals that we'll be using have a, they call it type 3 distribution, so that there's very little light on the backside. Most of the light goes away from the homes.
The street lights. Yeah.
Okay, that's good. Are there any other questions? Is there anyone who has from the audience? Mr. Gibbons.
I'm John Gibbons, and for these purposes, I'm here representing First Parish. I have three questions. Principally regarding Elm Street, when is construction anticipated? And I understand there are all kinds of residences that will need access, but our church access is principally from Elm Street, and should okay. we anticipate any period when we would not have access?
They're not doing that much there.
Do I have to speak into this?
Yeah.
The project is going to be bid in April, at the end of this month. Construction will probably start at the end of May, maybe the beginning of June.
After the plant fair.
There will be contract coordination for any access that has to be shut down for a little bit. But there's going to be, you'll always be allowed into your property, in and out of your property. There'll just be some temporary shutdowns when they have to pave or pour concrete for the sidewalks, things like that.
Thank you.
Well,
my second question, is there a net gain or a loss of parking places on School Way compared to at present?
There's a gain, and I would have to forward that information to you. But there is definitely a gain, because most of the parking on School Way right now is illegal. It's not formal parking, so we're actually making formal parking stalls on School Way.
If I remember correctly, when DPW put down some temporary paint on School Way, it was more or less what we see here
yeah.
now. That the paint that's there represents the project. The final project, I think, will have the same number, if I'm looking at this correctly, will have the same number as are indicated by that paint. Is that correct, Adrian?
Yes.
Okay.
We do not have a successful resolution of legal parking places there, because there continues to be overparking there and dangerous blocking of Elm Street and other access throughout that intersection.
I actually think that when the final hardscape is done, that will help address that problem, because there will be little bump outs for those parking stalls along the northern side of School Way that will make it impossible for people to park, except really literally in the middle of the street.
My final question is whether the DPW has come to any resolution about the former crosswalk between the Town Common and Old Town Hall.
I think we just mentioned that.
How do you feel about that?
I favor it.
It's de facto anyway.
No, of course not.
I mean, people use it, whether there's a...
But it's not a marked...
It's not, there's nothing marked. There used to be.
It looks like it is, though, because it's paint on it.
There used to be, and people who are in the habit of crossing there still cross there. Mm-hmm. People who don't know that used to be a crosswalk might not try it now.
And there's a curb cut from the common, mm-hmm. and it leads to a curb cut in front of Old Town Hall.
And now
I understand the state regs regarding distance from a traffic signal and all of that, but I think there needs to be some more formal resolution.
Particularly if there's going to be a bus stop there.
The only thing that I have to say is that traffic does queue back beyond that location.
Oh, sure.
And if people are trying to cross the road and traffic starts moving, there will definitely be a blind spot there, and it is a safety issue for pedestrians in that crosswalk. So if you formalize it and you invite people to use it, especially during peak hours when people are doing things that they're not supposed to do while driving, it's just causing a conflict point between the pedestrian and the motorist.
I would once again respectfully bring up the example of Chelmsford Center, where they have put raised crosswalks in a very congested area, right when you come into that central area right by 110. Mm-hmm. And I would imagine that although, you know, perhaps we have a greater incidence of truck traffic or that our queue lines are longer, that's a very complicated area there. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I know that the issue of whether or not raised crosswalks were acceptable in Bedford, whether or not we could accommodate them in terms of our snow plowing, but it just seems as though this is brand new installation of crosswalks and sidewalks in a neighboring town where the circumstances must be quite similar to Bedford.
Actually, it's not quite. We did that one, too. So, they installed everything. It was a Mass DOT project. We installed everything, and then the town went in afterwards and installed a few of the raised crosswalks because the state wouldn't pay for it because of the proximity to the intersections. But the location that I'm thinking of where they did install one was far enough away from the intersection that there wasn't sight distance issues with the crosswalk itself. It was on 27, actually. So, you know, we can take a look at it. We can make some recommendations. Maybe even if you have wigwags or some alert system so that people actually can see that people are mm-hmm. in the crosswalk itself. But just putting in something that, you mm-hmm. know, if a little kid's behind a car that's parked there and all of a sudden the traffic starts rolling again, it's just an issue. That's all.
Is the bus stop going to be right where the curb cut is?
No. Mm-mm. It's closer to the intersection a little bit, but it's going to be in the same proximity.
Ms. Lloyd.
Ann Lloyd. I have several comments, concerns. At South Springs and Great Road, particularly in the wintertime, that is, even though I think you've eked out a few more inches in the southbound lane onto South Road, it is a constant problem because cars park further out from the curb along the common than any normal parking spot because there's no sidewalk there. And so when the snow is plowed up, people have no choice if their passengers want to get out of their car than to park further out. And so I've frequently found in the wintertime that effectively the northbound two lanes are narrowed down to one. Or I've seen cars trying to turn, or bigger trucks trying to turn southbound, and then having to just stop and wait till traffic in the two northbound lanes clears in order to get through. And so while I suspect that the business owners at the corner wouldn't like the elimination of those three parking spots, it seems like, to me, like that's an opportunity to gain some width that's desperately needed and use those for some combination of widening the lanes, making a little more of a green strip to separate the pedestrians from the curb, from the traffic, whatever.
I'm taking a look at it right now. I agree with you that, especially with snow, the parking stalls are essentially where the bulb out is, where the bus stop is going southbound on south. So even if you eliminate those two parking stalls, they're away from the travel lane. It's not really going to change the geometry at the parking lane that's on South Road right next to the common. Does that make sense?
She's talking about the other side.
Yeah.
But I guess I'm wondering why they can't. If those are eliminated, those two northbound lanes can suddenly be shifted.
You'd have to shift the whole thing. It's not something that you can have like a curve right at that location. It has to be
And then my one other concern is at the lower part of Elm Street,
yep.
South of Maplewood School. I can't tell you how many times I've seen cars come down Elm Street from the upper part and just fly right through the stop sign mm-hmm. to the lower part of Elm Street. And I think that I see that you've bumped out the little tiny bit to create some room for a sidewalk at that house that's very, very close to the corner. It's right on the street.
Yep.
I think that you should actually make an active curve to that lower part of Elm Street entrance on the school way so that there's just no opportunity for people to fly through that intersection. They essentially have to make a right-hand turn and then a left-hand turn.
We did take a look at that as one of the options for design development. I think this, because the roadway, the Elm Street, the upper Elm Street to lower Elm Street is not a straight shot. You can't just zip through there.
You can. People do.
Well, after
it'll be curved. That's going to be curbed, correct?
Yes, it's going to be curved, and we've shifted the alignment so that the
right. It's lower, almost like a dog leg now.
That's right. So the lower Elm Street doesn't line up with
right.
the upper Elm Street, so you
right.
can't just drive straight through on that.
Seems like there could be some enforcement possibilities there, because once the car's down on the lower part of Elm Street, there's no way out. So. Shouldn't be too hard to apprehend the violator.
So we'll pass that information along to the
They haven't
police
figured
department.
It out yet.
Okay. Great. So at this point, you said that the projects are getting close to being ready to go to
yeah,
bid?
We're bundling the three up right now, and we're going to be bidding it at the end of the month, advertising it at the end of the month for a bid opening sometime in May.
Okay.
Roy, can you communicate with Dave Coelho in the superintendent's office? I think he's the transportation guru, and I just think it would be helpful for them to know what the timetable is and make any adjustments, especially in terms of bus traffic.
Yeah, once we get the bids back and we actually bring the contract forth with the contractor and we'll figure out staging according to what's going on, what month it is. And stage it properly the best we can to accommodate the areas.
What we're looking for is that all the major construction happened during the summer months,
mm-hmm.
So that it's not going to impact any of the bus operations.
That would be great. Or Bedford Day.
Or Bedford Day, right. I'm sorry.
Right.
Any other questions?
Thank you.
We're all set.
Thank you.
I'm
Thanks
very,
very
sorry
much.
About this.
No, this
worked. This worked.
I can send that in color if you want.
It's beautiful. You should see it on my screen. It really looks nice.
Sure.
Sure.
Yeah.
That'll be fine.
Electronically.
That'll be great. Yeah. That way, if anyone has any questions, we have it.
Thank you.
Thanks very
Thank
much
you.
For coming. So next on our agenda, we have a draft statement addressing the recent incidents in town. I know that everyone's probably aware of the community meetings that have happened over the past couple of weeks. And Mr. Reed has drafted this statement and presented it to us as an opportunity for us to go on record about this situation. Is there anything else you would like to add?
No, with some feedback after some of you saw this draft over the weekend, it's slightly amended today, so it doesn't really change the content or intent significantly. There is also another follow-up meeting on Thursday afternoon here at Town Hall.
Okay.
I think this is wonderfully worded. It's powerful. It diffuses those who say that love your neighbor is too gentle a response, and I really like the way it's defined here. My question is whether we should ask the school committee to sign on with this, unless they've already issued their own statement.
I imagine they would. It's up to them. I imagine they wouldn't have a problem with it, but I don't want to put you know, unnecessarily obligate them to sign on to it. I think we could just provide them the same information, and if they want to issue the same statement, that's great. I think the superintendent has already himself issued some statements.
Gone on with this.
Yeah, and I think you know those of us who've participated individually in the meetings have certainly brought the weight of the attention of the selectmen to this issue, but certainly representing the town at large, mm-hmm. I think that we can move ahead with the statement, and you know, I think it represents the community and everyone in it when the selectmen mm-hmm. say something.
What is the intent of where this will go?
We'll distribute it to the media that covers us.
Just web page.
So they have it.
Yeah, we can put it on our web page.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I'll just also add, some of you probably saw that the Boston Globe had written an editorial back Saturday, March, I think it was 29th, and the superintendent and I were not, we were concerned about the wrong impression that editorial might have created, and so we decided we would write a response, which actually ended up getting published today. Youth and Family Services Director helped write the initial response, and then the superintendent and I edited it and changed it a little bit, in particular because we were forced to reduce it to 250 words or so. So, but that was published today in the Boston Globe.
Mm-hmm. Well, I have to say that I'm sure everyone recognizes how much time and attention these issues have taken on behalf of the school committee and Superintendent School Sills, but also I just wanted to acknowledge Mr. Reed for the time that you've taken to address many people's concerns and to show up to the meetings. So I think that the town should be commended for its appropriate response to this situation.
Also, our police department has been very much involved.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
So do you need anything other than our just saying go for it?
That's it.
Okay. Thank you very much. Okay, and we've got minutes. March 10th, that was a doozy.
I have a few, if you want somebody to start. Throughout the document, there's references to seasons, spring and fall. Should they be capitalized? So that's a question.
To what?
Spring and fall.
Associated Press style book doesn't capitalize.
All right, then we'll move on just to other. So on page 5, under definitions of thresholds for considering contracted services, reevaluated, I think, might need a hyphen in between there. Down below there in Depot Park, just to clarify, Mark, in the last sentence, it says that it would make sense to find out the cost of removing the second floor. Is that what you proposed? Removing the whole
Yeah.
Okay.
I
know we had the conversation. I was well aware of it, but that seemed to simplify what I thought you were saying. But if you're happy with it, that's fine. That's all.
Page 4, one up from the bottom, recreation field development. I want to add The town is waiting for the judge's ruling on the variance. Add the words "in connection with the so-called St. Michael's property." That's it for me.
Anything else?
Page 7, mm-hmm, in the motions to appoint the Charter Review Committee. The second to the last motion has Mr. Moonen making the motion and then voting against it. I don't think he did make the motion. I think I made the motion. That was the motion to appoint Steve. No, actually, and I'm listed as seconding it, so.
I can't listen to it.
Yeah, we probably need to check. I just don't remember Bill making
it could
the
have
motion.
Been Mark, it could have been it. Mark and Mike.
I don't think I did, but I might have. I don't know. We'll have to see if anybody saw it on television.
Yeah. There you go. You can check the tape. All right.
Okay. Anything else?
No.
I'll move the minutes of March 10th as amended.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, abstained, 400. Bless you. So the minutes of the meeting we had before town meeting on March 24th.
Move that minutes of March 24th be approved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Aye. Opposed, abstained, 400. Mr. Reed.
I'm all set for this evening. We've covered everything we need to.
Great. Caroline?
I am all set as well.
Mark?
I guess I would just make a quick comment on the charrette for the Coast Guard property, which was well attended and I thought was interesting. I have to admit, personally, I was a little concerned that it started as a very wide open exercise, including potential use of the property, that I didn't realize there were people out there thinking that that was a potential use for the property. But I thought it was an interesting cross-section of people. I think it was very nice to see residents from all over town. You know, sometimes you have these things, especially around a piece of property, and it's the neighbors and all of the most active people who come and try to contribute to something. And I looked at the list afterwards, and there were people who are concerned about this from neighborhoods that aren't anywhere near this property. And I think it's to their credit that they came and wanted to be involved. And I thought the discussion was interesting. I'm a little concerned about the timing for what will really happen and how long it will take for anything to happen, if something does happen. But I thought the exercise was a good one.
Usually there's not enough time.
Yeah.
Now there just seems to be too much of it.
Yes, well, you're right. Sometimes we're reacting as quickly as possible, and here we have a little more time to plan, I guess.
And, you know, it should be said that there's a follow-up meeting on
May
15th.
May 15th, right.
To present the ideas that the facilitators and engineers have listened to, and you know,
right,
with some proposals or some conceptual ideas of how the property could be developed.
Mm-hmm. Can you give us an idea of how we're monitoring the process, as opaque as it seems to be, on the government, on the federal side? If do we need to call them every week and say, has it been given to GSA?
I will call them and just let them know that the charrette occurred, and they did know it was scheduled, and also just tell them about the follow-up date, and find out ask them if they can inform us when they make decisions on starting and commencing the process for selling the property.
And do we feel confident that they will?
Still in the Coast Guard's control, right?
So we'll keep calling.
And then, do you know if there's a minimum amount of time that they have to, that the process has to be open to the federal government before it moves on to the next level?
Well, you may not have understood what was said, Mike, at the meeting last week. But basically, the GSA has told me that they will be opting for an alternative process that doesn't make the land available to other federal or state government entities. They're planning to bid it out for a private sale, and this alternative statute that exists is one that the agency that holds the property can elect to utilize, because they intend to keep the funds that are derived from the sale of the property and reinvest it in their housing assets elsewhere. So the Coast Guard is going to get the funds that are, you know, generated by selling this property, and they're just looking to get the maximum value they can for the property.
Mm. So it sounds a lot more like a private property mm-hmm. owner selling it on the open market rather than the federal government selling it to return the funds to the federal government. This is they're keeping it, and so therefore they can direct it differently.
Mm-hmm. Yes, they keep they will sell the property like a normal, you know, property owner might sell the property, and the only difference will be, I'm sure they're governed by a whole statutory process that determines the schedule and those types of things. But the funds will get returned to the U.S. Coast Guard after the GSA sells the property, and they are asked or required by this alternative process to reinvest the money in their own housing for elsewhere that they have it.
I'm glad that isn't happening on Hartwell Road yet, with the GSA's administration of the surplus Navy property.
Yeah.
Mike, do you have anything?
Rick, do you think that we should include on the agenda at the end of the month reviewing the liaison assignments?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the chair and I were discussing that the other day. We want to wait till Selectman Moonen gets back to the meetings, which I'm not
sure. Yeah, I guess that's only fair. Carolyn, you say anything about Nick?
An interesting list.
Oh, I didn't.
You want to?
I don't know if everybody is aware or not, but the assistant director of recreation is leaving us. I don't know exactly when his last day is. This Friday?
I believe, yes. Yeah.
And we wish him well. It's a loss, in my opinion. He's served, a very difficult position between the schools and the parents and the children and the committees and the coaches, and he has done that with great professionalism and put a lot of extra effort into, you know, everything he's done. So I know he's going to be missed in that department and missed from a coach, from a parent perspective on my end. I was on the soccer committee with him and rec commission interactions, so we'll miss him and wish him well.
That's it for me.
Rick, do we have anything, any update on our economic development position?
It's not finalized. I did have a meeting today, but should be shortly.
Okay, yep. So you'll keep us posted. Okay, that's all I have everyone else covered on my issues. So,
I move we adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. 4-0-0.
Watch the game.